really looking forward to having you all here and having Mrs. Plutkin, also known as Goldie, with us. I'd like to start and first thank all those people, wonderful women who helped out. It takes a village to put something together. I wrote it down so I don't forget. I'll start with thanking Joni. Where are you?
I'm here.
Joni, thank you so much for allowing us to use this beautiful facility, and we hope to come back and use it as a spot. thank you. And thank you all the women who helped out. We have Shoshana Lau, my mother-in-law, Leah Greenberg, Ulysses Lorber, Gitti Myers, Rafi Shanowitz, Brachele, Greenberg, Sonia Young, Hani Lakowski, Andrea Strasberg, and Shira Cohen. If I left anyone out. And of course, thank you, Goldie, for coming all the way from Ontario, Canada, to be with us and share some words of inspiration. And thank you to the Mikveh Buffalo and Mikveh USA for sponsoring this lovely event. So, now about Goldie. Born and raised in Crown Heights, Goldie and her husband built a beautiful shul, a beautiful synagogue and center in Markham, Ontario. It's a wonderful shul with one of the largest memberships in Canada, so really impressive. Goldie is the director of a really wonderful preschool called Floritas, thriving preschool. And she's also a sought-after international speaker, and we are so thrilled to have you here. Through her unique animated style of speaking, she captures audience attention, and she presents a no-nonsense approach, practical approach to life's most complex issues, most sensitive issues, things that people don't always want to talk about. Goldie's a graduate of Beth Rivka Teachers Seminary, and she received her BCE degree at Seneca College and York University. And her most important job is being a mother. Goldie is a mother, a proud mother, of 8 wonderful children. And once again, we are thrilled to have Goldie with us. You didn't come to listen to me, so Goldie. Wow, thank you for that wonderful introduction. But one thing was left out. Baruch Hashem, I'm also a grandmother, and I just had my 9th granddaughter coming to her 10 days ago. But another milestone that's happening this Thursday night is we have a little Down syndrome son. He's 13, our youngest, and he's having his bar mitzvah this Thursday night. So it's very overwhelming. I made 4 bar mitzvahs for typical children, and now I'm making one for a special needs child. I don't know what to expect. And all the 500 guests that are coming might seize on me, maybe he won't come, but there will definitely be a lot of good music, fireworks, and a great barbecue. And so it's a very interesting time in my life now, but Hashem just sort of comes with you in every step in your life, and I think it's about opening yourself up and just allowing Hashem in. The other day I was speaking to, this is totally off topic, by the way, what time is it now? 8 o'clock. Well, what time do you want me to stop?
10:30.
I was speaking to a mother whose child is also Down syndrome, and we were discussing some of the challenges. And I said, Lisa, do you ever talk to God? Like, not just open a siddur or a tehillim, you just talk to him. She was like, what do you mean? I said, I'll give you an example. The other day, Zami was just acting totally rational. He was throwing things all over the room and messing up his room and stripping the beds from the linen. And I had to run to school. I run a preschool. I have my teachers coming in. And I just sat down and I said, listen, Hashem, there are 3 of us in this marriage, my husband and I and you. It's time for you to kick in. And I promise you, it wasn't 5 minutes that something snapped in Zalman. He just got himself together. Even sort of said sorry in his way, and we got on with our day. That's just a sidebar, and I'm sure it's going to flow into my lecture tonight, but I think as Jewish women, we have to be very cognizant. Hashem isn't an abstract idea, a God you speak to 2-3 times a year in the synagogue. Hashem is part and parcel of our daily lives, and he makes it beautiful, and he makes it functional, and he makes it manageable. But today I want to talk to you about, here's our topic. It's a very long topic, by the way. And a lot of details. Okay. Something about love, right? Love and marriage, immersion of body, mind, and soul. Okay, I got it. Okay. In the mid-1930s, thank you, Joanie. In the mid-1930s, under the Stalin regime, there was a young girl, about 19 years old, who was engaged to a young yeshiva boy. His name was Bensi. And the two of them were set to get married in Russia under this very, very challenging time. But the Chatan and Kala were focused on marriage, on building up a Jewish home, and nothing was going to stop them until the young fiancé, Bensi, was arrested for opening yeshivot, opening Jewish schools, when the communist regime would not allow that. And so he was shipped off to Siberia, to labor camp, where he was sentenced for 25 years to life. Everyone turned to the bride and said to her, "My dear girl, what are you going to do now? You can't marry a man who's going to be sentenced for life in Siberia. It's time for you to call for engagement." And this young girl said, "This is my bashert. He is my soulmate. And I'm going to follow him to Siberia." And she did. She took a bus Sunday morning, packed a small valise with food and clothing, and traveled for 6 days until it was Friday afternoon, at which point the sun was beginning to set. She got off the bus, she opened up her valise, lit her Shabbos candle, and walked towards the prison. She finally made it to the prison gates, where she was allowed in to meet her fiancé. And a few days later, they were prepared to get married. In fact, the chatan, the fiancé, made her a ring out of a prison spoon. All was set, enough Jewish witnesses. You can imagine how the Jews were sitting in Siberia, unfortunately, under Stalin. The witnesses were set. Chuppah was put together. There was one problem. The bride had to go to the mikveh. Now, I saw you, Buffalo Mikveh. There was nothing even nearly comparable in Siberia. What was the Kala going to do? She was not going to get married without going to the mikveh. A tradition that her mother, her grandmother, her great-grandmother, all the way up to our matriarchs had done. She didn't want to sever that link. So what did this young woman do? She took an axe and broke the frozen ice in a nearby lake, and she immersed herself in the mikveh. Now, I know this story is true, because this young girl was my bubby. My bubby Golden, who I named after. And any time I may have some challenges or some consequential thoughts regarding the challenge of mikveh, or even challenges of speaking to others about it, I think about what my grandmother went through, and totally everything comes to me. That self-sacrifice to immerse in a frozen water because she would not get married without going into the beautiful waters of Mikveh is a tradition that has been passed down from generation to generation. And it's a mitzvah that we cherish as her grandchildren, especially as my namesake. It's a mitzvah that resonates with me, and I'm passionate about mikveh. In fact, when I came here, so I was passing through the customs, and the guy says, "So you're American, you're Canadian?" I said, "I'm both. Where do you live? Toronto. What brings you to Buffalo?" I said, "I'm giving a lecture on marriage." He says, "Oh, I know nothing about marriage." I said, "Well, it starts at 7:30. If you want, you can meet us there." It would have been okay if he came. You know, there's an extra seat right here. Kidding aside, I am passionate about marriage, about relationships, about mikveh, about the strength and the beauty of the Jewish couple. And I speak about it wherever, whenever, and even if we're discussing desserts, you can be sure I'll do a little dropping of the word mikveh. maybe a little about communication. I'll throw in a little bit about the five love languages. It's one of my passions, and everyone in this room has a passion. That became mine. And I think it's because my grandmother broke ice to immerse. It might have something to do. It really resonates with me. You know, in every relationship, specifically in a Jewish marriage, we talk about bringing God into our home. So the cute story of these three guys who made it across the ocean after World War II, it was Moshe, it was Chaim, and it was David. They landed in Ellis Island, and they each decided that they were going to seek their fortune. And they're standing and discussing, you know, what should they do? They're three guys from Europe, they barely speak English. What can they do for a living in New York? So Moshe says, you know, my name is Moshe Diamond. I think I'm gonna go off into diamonds. The other one said, my name is Taylor. I think I'm gonna get into the clothing industry. The other one goes, oh, my last name is Gold. I'm gonna seek my fortune in the gold. And so 40 years later, they had this beautiful reunion in the Hyatt Hotel in Manhattan. All the big shots, they walked in, they didn't look like they looked in Ellis Island 40 years earlier. They had beautiful Hugo Boss suits, nice little kerchiefs, fancy shoes. They're all sitting down around the table having a nice drink. And they said, no? So how did it go in the last 40 years? How did things work out for all of you? So the first one says, remember, my name is Moshe Taylor. I'm sorry, my name is Moshe Diamond. I went into the diamond business, and you know what? It was beautiful. You know those stores in all the airports, Diamond and Diamond? They're mine. Wow, that's your place? That's amazing, you did well. Yeah, Baruch Hashem, I did great. And what about you, Mr. Gold? Oh, me, I told you I was gonna seek my fortune in the gold industry. You ever heard of Gold Incorporated? They are all over in every single airport in US and Europe. That's you? It's me. Wow, you did well too. Well, what about you? Taylor, how did it work for you? He goes, oh, I went into the shmata industry. I started peddling socks. I started selling vests. Then I went into kerchiefs. I started trying hats. Nothing worked. Nothing. I said, that's terrible. So you can look like you're doing okay. Well, one night I was sitting in my house and I turned to God. I said, listen, God, I want to cut a deal with you. I'm going to start a new business. If it works out, 50-50. Whatever I make, I'm going to give 50. Sent the chairman. You're in? So he said, no. How did it work? Well, you never heard of Lord and Taylor. So we gotta bring God into every one of our experiences in our relationships, whether it's at work, whether it's at home, whether it's with our family. We need to bring in Hashem's blessing into our relationships. And especially I think today, we're living in an era, and I'm sure in Buffalo it's similar to Toronto, everything today is disposable. Your washing machine breaks down, you throw it out. Your dishwasher, your computer, your camera. Who gives a camera in to fix? When was the last time you even gave your phone in to fix? It breaks, you throw it out. Psychologically, we have been accustomed to throwing things out. And some people have dubbed us as the disposable society. We're just throwing things out. I mean, who even uses, you know, real dishes anymore? We're throwing out paper goods.
I do.
That's right, because I'm trying to get away from that way of thinking. Thank you, Mr. Barbino. I use my china every Shabbos, whether there's 25 people or not, and my husband wants to know why. Why? Because I don't want to be part and parcel of a disposable society. But I think it's interesting. I think that way of thinking is creeping into our psyche. And it's not so much with computers and phones and cameras anymore. It's also beginning to affect relationships. So a relationship isn't working out. You know, there's a better model somewhere else. I could trade in. I can upgrade a little bit. And we become accustomed to that way of thinking, God forbid, this is really in reality what's affecting us in our relationships. And I think the key to bringing sanctity and godliness into our home is the key to making our marriages lifelong and fulfilling, so that the person we stood with under the chuppah is hopefully the person we are buried. I know it's a long term, I know it's sometimes far-fetched, but tonight I would like to address the three ways that God can be brought into our marriage through mind, body, and soul. Because I think if we change a little bit the way we think, and we start viewing our lives a little bit different, we can have an absolutely perfectly successful relationship. It's all about perspective. Let's discuss mind. I have a woman sitting right here. She's a psychotherapist who deals with mindfulness. Am I right, Mr. Barra?
It's true.
It's one of the biggest buzzwords today, is being mindful. Now, as a Rebbetzin in a community, I do get to see many young women and women of all ages who come to speak to me on challenges in relationships, specifically in marriage. And it really surprises me when we get to talking about the intimacy component of relationship, where women will say to me, oh, there's no joy, there's no sparks anymore. We're married already 12 years, really. The romance has died. I'm quite puzzled at that, because when we get married, we don't say that this is the happiest moment of our life. We say this is the beginning of the happiest moments of our life. Going into a relationship, we have to be mindful and focus on every single part and parcel of our marriage. Every part and parcel. And I want to focus today on the intimacy component, because any marriage expert or any marital therapist will tell you that if there's a challenge in the bedroom, unfortunately, it translates into challenges in every other part of the relationship. And even though we could say, well, you know, I'm fine, I'm not a physical person, I don't need that component, we're great friends, we don't need to really have intimacy. Or we can say, you know, I'm so holy, or I'm so religious, I'm above that. Absolutely wrong. A solid marriage begins in the bedroom. And you can look and say, what? A Rebbetzin says such things? Do you know that in the Holy of Holies, that's the holiest place in our temple, there lay the what? What was inside the Holy of Holies? Does anybody know? Which part of the temple was housed in the Holy of Holies? The angels sat on what? What was that called? The ark. That's right. There were two angels called the cherubs, made out of gold, that were positioned right on top of the Aron HaKodesh. Now, do you know that the cherubs, their relationship, reflected the relationship between the Jews and Hashem, Jews and God? When the Jewish people were connected to God, the cherubs were in an intimate relationship. If God forbid they weren't, they were back to back. And we're told that when the Babylonians came in to destroy our temple, they made a beeline straight for the Holy Ark. And when they walked in, they saw the cherubs in a coin's position. And they were repulsed. Because this is Judaism? This is the holiest place of Judaism? And you're signifying that by two cherubs having intimacy? They missed the point. They missed the point. My dear friends, Judaism celebrates relationships. In Judaism, the word for marriage isn't just marriage or union. It's called kiddushin. You know what the word kiddushin means? Think about kadosh, kaddish, kiddush. Does that word mean anything to you? Right? What do we make on Friday night? Kiddush. When someone passes away and we make the special blessings for 11 months, what are we saying? Kaddish. The root of a marriage is kiddushin, the word for holiness. You know, sometimes, as Jews, we live in a Christian society, And so we tend to see the world through Christian view. Although we're Jewish, and we celebrate our Judaism, and we have our Jewish traditions, we still see things through the Christian viewpoint. It's just natural. If you're living and you're a minority amongst the Christians, that, so the Christian view on marriage is such that the priest, the pope, they're celibate, right? The holiest place for them is the church and the monastery. In Judaism, the rabbi and the rebbetzin have to be very married. In fact, most of the rebbetzins, you know, have large families. So the rabbi and rebbetzin are not only married, they're very, very married. And they celebrate intimacy. Obviously, 8 to 10 children, Kreinahara, there's got to be moments that they're spending in the bedroom. Marriage, kiddushin, holiness, this is what Judaism celebrates. And so much so that even in the Jewish law, and this is a very fascinating thing, you know, Code of Jewish Law talks about every single thing we're allowed to do, we're not allowed to do. Yom Kippur, you're not allowed to weather, you're not allowed to eat, you're not allowed to drive, you're not allowed to do this, you gotta do this, 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 it goes kosher. Oh, you're not allowed to mix this and this. If you mix this, then you have to kosher it this way, you have to put it into this, and the hot water, the cold water, and the cheese, and everything is detailed in Code of Jewish Law. Did you know that when it comes to laws of intimacy, actual relationship in the bedroom is very little written in Shulchan Aruch. Is very little. Because we do learn how a Jew and how a Jewish husband and a wife treat one another in the bedroom. But God wants us to love being together. God wants us to be mindful when we're together. God wants us to focus and to be exclusive. Do you know how hard that is today in a world where everyone's thinking about everything else? And to be focused on the moment during intimacy on each other? We're living in a time zone where everyone's multitasking. Everyone's thinking about 15 things at the same time. But when it comes to intimacy, the Torah says, I want you to focus on each other. It's a beautiful story that just resonated with me. It was a story that's written in the Talmud of a rabbi who used to spend many, many hours teaching his students. And Baruch Hashem, his wife had a large family as well. One day, someone stopped him on his way to synagogue and said, you know, Rabbi, you really should stop spending so much time at the synagogue and spending some time with your son. And the rabbi says, what happened? He goes, well, I was at the park the other day. Your son was throwing rocks and misbehaving and saying inappropriate words. That's not befitting for a rabbi's son. And the rabbi says this. He says, it's impossible that was my son. Know what I was thinking when I was intimate with his wife, with my wife. You hear that? I know what I was thinking when I was intimate with my wife. Focusing on the intimacy, because when a husband and a wife are intimate with each other, they are creating souls. Whether there are going to be souls that are going to come into children, actual children, or even just godly souls. Every time a couple has a relationship, they are creating souls. That's not something Christianity talks about. I remember coming back from Ukraine a couple years ago, and I was sitting next to a young woman. She was a journalist, and I pulled out my siddur to say the blessing for the trip, and she leans over and she goes, oh, what's that? And I said, oh, it's a siddur, it's a prayer book. Oh, you're Jewish? I said, yeah. So she says to me, what do you do? I said, well, I'm a rebbetzin, the rabbi's wife. She says, well, you know, she says, it's so interesting in the Jewish religion. She says, I'm Greek Orthodox. We don't go to church anymore, she says. We have no interest in going to the church. I said, really? To me, it seems like the churches are packed on Sundays. She says, no, there's no connection between us and the priest. You see, he's not married. He doesn't understand what I'm going through in life. If I have a problem with my husband, do you think he gets it? He's not married. He doesn't understand women's emotions. The week before her period, the week of her period, the week after her period. You think he understands squabbles and problems and tiredness and veins and oh, he doesn't get it. So we don't even have any connection. We stop going. And I was just thinking about that for the next 10 hours of the trip. I thought about how brilliant that God made the leaders of our people. He made them married. Moses had to be married. Aaron think about Abraham and Sarah. These who are the people who we look up to. And they were married because that union teaches us something so important. It teaches us how to relate. It teaches us how to have compassion. It teaches us how to have patience. You don't get that just from preaching in a synagogue. You get that from living in real life. And so being in the moment, being mindful, that's one of the most important things I think that our generation is going to struggle with. And if not us, even more so our children. Because they are multitasking everything. There's WhatsApp, there's Snapchat, there's Facebook, this phone and that phone, everything's going on. And how do we stay focused on our spouse, on the moment? Exclusivity. That's the key. And in fact, the Torah does tell us when we're not allowed to have relationships. When one of the partners is drunk, if one of the partners is asleep, if one of the partners is angry at the other, contemplating divorce, the Torah says no, there's no space for intimacy. Because intimacy isn't something we do just to make up. Intimacy is connecting. Two souls connecting, and you have to be in the same place, in the same zone. I want to talk now about the soul. What's the soul connection in a relationship? This is a powerful story that I think took place about 3 or 4 years ago. In northern Israel, war had broken out. It was the summertime, and they were recruiting all their soldiers. Unfortunately, they were fighting from the north and the south, and they needed all their reserves. And typically, Israel does not call young married men to come up to war. They give them a year break. Unfortunately, they needed every young IDF possible, and this young man who just got married 5 months earlier was called up and drafted to the army. He went up to fight very valiantly, not before saying goodbye to his wife, told her to see her very soon, and Rahman al-Islam, unfortunately, he was attacked, and his leg was caught with sharp shrapnel, and they had to amputate his right leg. He's lying in the hospital up north, and he calls his wife, and he says to her, "My dear Motik," which he means sweetheart, he says, "I have to tell you, I was just in a very, very fierce battle. Some of my friends were killed. I thank God alive. I want to tell you that I lost a leg. And I want you to know that I understand emphatically if you want a divorce. Because you are so young and beautiful. You don't deserve to live with a man with one leg." And she responds, "My dear Motik, when I married you because you're my soulmate. I didn't marry you because of your legs, and you're still here." This story, when I heard it, it resonated with me so much. Because once again, we have to believe intrinsically that if we made it to the chuppah, if God led us to that path, for so many years of searching our soulmates, I'm sure there are people here that can fill up a book with the most fascinating ways you met your spouse. And for those of you who didn't, Yemei Teshem, you should. Quickly and soon. But God infinitely makes us have our paths crossed so that our souls, which have been separated from birth, you see, up in heaven, every single soul is comprised of a male and female. And right before birth, the souls separate. And the female part of the soul goes into the body of the world, and the male part of the soul goes into the body of the world. After 20, 30 years, their soul objective is to meet each other and to unite. And we as Jews believe that. We understand the word bashert. We hear it in every single chuppah. The question is, does it become part and parcel of our psyche? Do we internalize that message? If God forbid I had an infection in my arm, and I go to the best doctor, he says, "You know, Goldie, I hate to tell you, there's nothing we can do, but guess what? There's a surgeon next door. He'll amputate your arm this afternoon, no problem." I'm like, "Huh? I think I'm going to do some more searching, thank you very much. And I'll travel the world to save my arm. My arm is me. I'm not giving it up so fast. I let's take that same value and think about our soulmate. We are one together. We are part of each other. We don't dispose of it. We are one soul. And that is why learning our Torah and our tradition, which gives us the understanding that awareness that the marriage wasn't just two coincidental beings who happened to meet at the same cafeteria or working in the same coffee shop. Oh, how coincidental. No, we believe in Mashiach, that God, the whole purpose of creation was to bring these two souls together to be reunited under that chuppah, that momentous occasion. And that's why whenever you go to a chuppah, tell me, you don't shed tears when you're sitting at a chuppah? No matter how many chuppahs I go to, I get emotional, I get choked up. I don't even know why. It could be a young couple, it could be an older couple, it could be a couple that's getting married a third time because they had to have three conversions. They couldn't get married in Russia according to Jews. And there's so many reasons. But every time I'm watching, I almost feel like the unifying of these two souls, and I'm witnessing God's miracle. Should we not put in effort to preserve God's miracle? Should we not put effort to preserve our hands, to find the right way? Listen, I'll give you another example. God gave me zombie 13 years ago. Do you think when he was not able to walk at 2 years old, I said to him, listen, zombie, I'm giving you 6 more medic sessions. Those are physiotherapies. You don't start walking, kid, I'm getting rid of you. Really? Really? I've given zombie therapy for 13 years. It's cost us an arm and a leg. But what wouldn't we do for a child who's intrinsically part of me? He's part of my essence. And how much more so is my husband? Because God's creation depended on me and my husband being united, and every single woman sitting here was married. Your union is the reason for God creating the world. And if we look at it through that lens, we will cherish it, and we will go for the therapy we need. And we will go and try, and we will see all the rabbis and the therapists, and we'll do whatever we need, because this is something worth preserving. The story I'm about to tell you, I think it's true. I'm still trying to go back for all these emails and stories and books that I've read, but it's a fantastic story, and I think the message really hits home. There was a young Hasidic couple, both from very, very illustrious families, who were set up on a shidduch date. And they went out on the first date. The girl came home a few hours later, and she tells her parents, amazing guy, really great guy. So the parents said, no, no, you want to continue dating? She says, I don't know. What? You just said some great stuff about this guy. There's something about him I'm not ready to share. You know what? You gotta always go on a second date. You can't make first impressions. Go out on a second date. So, wonderful daughter, she listened to her parents, she went out on a second date. Comes home a few hours later, again, totally ecstatic. This guy is everything I'm looking for. He's kind, he's compassionate, he's funny, he's intellectual, he's endearing, he's conversational, it's everything I want about him. Wonderful, no, no. So, are we ready to announce the engagement? Ma, it's two dates. I know, but we're a very, very respectful family. You know, we don't need... Mom, sorry, there's still something bothering me. After the fourth date, the girl decided she has to break it up. Here's what Teddy said. Because she was so excited to go out with this guy, he was so compatible. What could possibly be wrong? And so she said to her parents, Hunchback. He's a young guy, he's 23 years old. Mom, Ta, it's terrible. When we're sitting on the chair and talking, it's amazing. But the moment he gets up and takes me out the front door, it's so hard for me to look at him. He's so disfigured. Mom, I'm such a young girl, I can't live like this. Mother says, you know, you're right. And I would never force you into such a marriage. But I think, to do the right thing, go out again and tell them to come back. Just do the right thing. So they planned on the last date, and she tells him, it's wonderful getting to know you, and you're so compatible, everything's wonderful. but I'm going to have to decline on the offer. And he says, why? And she says, just say it. Because I know, it's the hunchback, I know. But before you leave, I just want to tell you something. He says, you know, 23 years ago, there was a soul in heaven that had a female soul and a male soul. And it was time for these two souls to descend. So the female soul went into the body of a little girl, and the male soul was going to go into the body of the male boy. And the male soul saw that his soulmate was going to have a terrible disfigured hunchback. And the male soul cried out to God, and he said, God, please, if we are one, and we are one together, can't I carry the hunchback? And he says to her, so I'm carrying the hunchback. You can take from the story what you like, but it's a very, very powerful message. Sometimes we look at our spouse, we sometimes see a flaw or a fault, a shtick, because we have nothing. We've got none of that. We are perfectos. But our spouse, that's a different story. Guess what? The spouse has our shtick. We share each other's issues, each other's problems. And the purpose of our reunion is to grow together and perfect each other. And so if I have patience for my shtick, which I do, and I have a lot, I hope I have the same patience for my husband, because his shtick is mine, and mine is his. And God gave us those challenges because we have to work together, to grow together. One of the things the Torah does talk about, the Shulchan Aruch actually does mention, is when a couple is intimate. It's a fascinating thing, actually. It says that the way that a Jewish couple should be intimate is that their eyes should be able to see each other. What does an eye tell you when you look at another person? What do eyes reveal to you? Huh? The soul? Yeah, what else? Do you ever have a little child who says, someone broke the cookie pie, it wasn't me, and you say, look me in the eye and tell me that again. Right, why do we say that? Okay, look me in the eye. Because the eyes tell the truth. The eyes see it all. When we have intimacy with our spouse and our eyes are looking at each other, we have the eyes, we have the body, we have the heart and the soul. And although many couples say, oh, I don't like that position, that, yes, there's ways in the Torah that talks about positions to make each other enjoy the intimacy, but there's something so valuable about understanding that although animals, when they are intimate with each other, when they are having their moments, they are not having eye to eye, Judaism is different. Judaism says we have to look at each other, being honest, truthful, open, deep, endearing, seeing, like you said, seeing to the soul. In fact, there's another such a beautiful thing. When babies nurse, when a human's baby nurses, the baby is facing the mother's eyes, as opposed to an animal that suckles from underneath the mother. Think about that. Think about how God created the structure of a human being. How understanding that the soul resonates and the soul speaks so much. And so the Jewish way of being intimate is different than the way the world out there is projecting and suggesting. Something to think about. In fact, the Zohar says something so powerful. It says that when a couple unites, it's pagla de gufa. They actually become not just one soul, but they become one body. Have you ever seen an elderly couple in their 90s walking together? I don't know about you, but to me, it is the most beautiful sight. Yeah, seeing a young couple walking together in love, nice. But that's typical. That's to be expected. When I look at a couple in their 80s, and they're still holding hands, or they're still being connected, and they're still gazing at each other, to me, I see what the Zohar, what Kabbalah says. They have become not only one soul, but now they've already become one body. story of a rabbi in Israel. Maybe both in their 80s, they were visiting the doctor, and the husband says to the doctor, "Doctor, please help my wife. Her foot hurts us. Her foot hurts us." That is how we as Jews work our goal to become one day not just one soul under the chuppah, but to work together to become one body. You know, some people say to me, "Goldie, I noticed that you and your husband never hold hands in public. How do your children see intimacy or see love?" And there were two things that came to my mind when I had to answer this friend. One of them was a story that a friend shared with me. She was, they were folding up the tablecloth on a Saturday night after Shabbat. And she was standing on one side, and her husband was on the other side, and they were just shaking off the crumbs and folding the tablecloth. And the little kids were giggling. And the mother says, "Kindleff, why are you giggling?" And he said, "Oh, it looks like you're kissing." How beautiful. The parents were folding the tablecloth, and their children saw closeness and fondness. You don't have to hold hands publicly to show that your children have to see beautiful talk, gazing of the eyes, respect, compassion, empathy. Non-demeaning words. That's how our children learn intimacy. And the other story was about a woman by the name of Esther Sarbransky. Some of you might know her. She was a respected woman from Australia. And she lived in Russia with, in a little house, let me say, two rooms. And she's had many guests. And one night, a young bachur, a young man, was staying at their house. And he heard that her and her husband having a conversation. And he wanted to sort of get a glimpse. And he peeked into the kitchen where they were sitting. And he says, he backed off because he felt like he was intruding on a very intimate moment. And all they were doing was sitting at the table and talking. But the way they were talking, the beauty, the words, the passion, says volumes more than any other physical act publicly can say. It starts with the eyes. It penetrates the soul, and then it connects with the body at the right place at the right time. And you see, so I want to talk to you a little bit about the body, because in Judaism, as we said, marriage is holy. So this story, people say, "Goldie, you make up your stories," but I don't make up any stories. So this scenario happened about 6 years ago. We were in Clearwater, Florida. Actually, the couple used to live here, now lives in Clearwater. They have six sons, and every time they have a bar mitzvah, we all go to the bar mitzvah. But they live in a neighborhood that doesn't have any nice hotels that are walking distance, so we always have to stay at the Red Roof Inn. Okay, Gil, have you ever stayed at the Red Roof Inn?
No.
2-star maybe? Most likely a 1-star. But because we have no choice, we all have to move in for Friday night to this Red Roof Inn. We hate it, but we do it for my sister. Right, what don't you do for family? So we all get into this Red Roof Inn. Up Friday Shabbos morning, we walk to the synagogue, we walk back. Anyway, Saturday night, Maza says, "You know, Goldie, we're going to move into another hotel. We have to leave 6 a.m. So we stayed in the hotel that night, but I really couldn't sleep. So really, we got up early. I said to Maza, "Let's just get out of here. Let's sit down by the pool." It was a semi-decent, maybe 2-star pool. But we sat, coming from Toronto in the winter, you know, like Buffalo, what wouldn't we do to sit at a pool in December? So 6 o'clock in the morning, we both go down to the water. Sure no one else would be there. Hoping no one else would be there. And so I'm sitting there, still wearing my little kerchief. My husband is sitting on the side, and he's davening. And all of a sudden, there's a creak of the door. And I'm like, "No. Whatever you do, do not come down to this pool." And sure enough, I give a look, and I see this man, huge, huge fellow, wearing a bathing suit, carrying a whole carton of cigarettes in one hand, and a case of beer, and I'm not exaggerating, and walks towards the pool. And in this huge, huge area, he decides to sit down next to us. And so I'm sitting there, really trying to relax a half hour before I have to catch a flight back to Toronto. My husband's davening on the side, and this guy is smoking and drinking and smoking and staring and smoking. And this went on for about a half hour. I was very, very uncomfortable. I was very unhappy. He was ruining my last half hour of sunshine. And then suddenly he gets up, and I'm like, "Thank goodness." Except he walks straight over to me and says, tree hugging kind of guy. Hans was nice, tree hugging kind of guy, nice. I'm Abraham, and I'm a Jew. He goes, Jew? So what do you do? I'm a rabbi. Oh, rabbi. What does a rabbi do? Now, Clearwater is not Miami Beach. It's totally the other side of Florida. Not popular with Jewish people, very few rabbis. In fact, there's probably one, my brother-in-law. So he says, what does a rabbi do? My mom says, well, we know, we teach our community about tradition, we're being closer to Judaism, we go through the Jewish holidays, we, you know, we work on family harmony. Oh, so you must be a priest. I said, yeah, well, maybe, sort of. And then he looks at me, he sizes me, and goes, ah, so you must be the nun. And I said, oh no, there are no nuns in Judaism. And I explained to him, in Judaism, we are married. And we are very, very married. He said, in Judaism, we celebrate relationships, and we celebrate the physicality of a marriage. In fact, one of the beautiful things about Judaism is that every single part of our life is like committed to godliness. You know, we're not just a Sunday group of people. We're Jewish when we eat, and we're Jewish when we walk across the street, and we're Jewish on a Friday because we light the Shabbos candles, and we're Jewish on a Monday when we have to buy our kosher food, and we're Jewish on a Tuesday when we have to give charity. We're Jewish all the time. It's a total experience. Judaism's totality. Every physical part of us, even our homes. I mentioned to you that the Holy of Holies is where the cherubs rested. In our homes, today we don't have a temple. And today our home is the holy, is the temple. And our bedrooms are the Holy of Holies. Our dining room is the place where they used to bring up the sacrifices. Every part of our home is holy. We bring a Shabbat meal to the dining room table, that becomes holy. We cook kosher, beautiful challahs in our stove, that becomes holy. So Judaism is a total experience. It's not just a single event that happens once in a while. And so in order to bring this marriage that we're talking about, this godliness, this feeling, God said, yes, relationships are beautiful. It's being mindful. It's understanding what's shared. But you also have to remember one thing. You want to invite a new idea into a marriage. And God called this